In this section, we shall study and prove the inverse function theorem, which is one of the most important results of all of calculus, probably. The proof will be probably the longest proof in all of mathematics 1 and 2, so this will really take a while. And one of the main ingredients will be the Banach fixed point theorem. This is crucial at that point because otherwise we really wouldn't be able to prove it without it. So we will see about this later. The title inverse function relates to something that we've already seen in mathematics 1, namely there we have studied differentiable functions between intervals and taken a look at the case if they were bijective, and if so, what the differential of the inverse map would look like. So we have seen there that if we have a function, differentiable function between two intervals where the derivative is non-vanishing at some point, then if it's bijective then the inverse map is again differentiable, and the derivative is basically the 1 over the value of the derivative at the respective point of the original function. So this was some result that we had, and so far we haven't studied inverse maps in the higher dimensional case. So if we have some map between differentiable map between subsets of Rn, between two open subsets of Rn, which is bijective, or when is it bijective, when can we invert this, and if it's invertible, so if we have an inverse map, do we know, if it's bijective, do we know that the inverse map is again differentiable or not? And these questions will be answered in this section and by this inverse function theorem. But before doing so, I want to motivate this again by studying equations. This is the system of equations I had in the introduction to the previous video. This is some very complicated system of equations. So I assume that u and v are some given parameters, and I want to find a solution. So I want to find x and y satisfying these equations. And in general, this looks very complicated. So it's not at all obvious if such solutions exist. So taking a look at the system doesn't really help. But there's one particular case where if you kind of think about the system a bit, you can find a solution. Namely, in the case that u and v are both zero. So both equations should be zero. If we take a look at the things here, and if we play around a bit with the numbers, we can really see a solution simply by just looking at it and trying out. So a solution of the system given by x equals zero and y equals zero. Then here we have zero squared plus zero times something minus the sine of zero, which is zero. And here the same, sine of x is zero, sine of zero is zero. And here we have zero times zero, so everything's vanishing. This is easy to see, but this is nothing spectacular. So this is just for that particular case, we can see an explicit solution. But of course, as soon as we have other parameters, there's no chance to really use that. So we have a solution given by this explicitly. Now, the idea would be, so if we have such a solution for these parameters here, I mean, all the functions involved are continuous and differentiable and so on. We have seen they behave nicely. So if we just modify these parameters a little, so if we're kind of in a small neighborhood around these parameters here, so if we just modify u and v to be close to zero, wouldn't it be somehow natural to expect that there was a solution which is also close to this solution? So if we kind of modify these parameters a bit, can we just wiggle around with the x and the y and find a solution again? This would be the idea that we would have. And we will later on see that in this particular example, this is indeed the case, and we will also see why. But the question would be also, can we wiggle the parameters a bit? So is there an open neighborhood, let's call it V of U, sorry, are there, I need, sorry, uh-huh. Let me rephrase this. So I need two open neighborhoods, are there open neighborhoods U and V of the origin in R2 such that if the parameters u and v are chosen to be in this small neighborhood, so the question is just if we have some small neighborhoods, we don't know how big or something, but if can we find such neighborhoods such that if the parameters are in there, then star, so this system of equations here has a solution in U. So does wiggling the parameters lead to wiggled solutions, so to say? So this is the question we want to tackle here. Now, this is where we will head back to in the end, but let me now get back to this inverse viewpoint and so on. And so let me basically a bit formalize what I said before, namely take two open subsets of some Rn, where n is an arbitrary number, and assume we have f from u to v, which is bijective and differentiable in some point of u. So in A, where A is point in u. Okay, so assume we have this. Now, what do we know about the differential of f and the differential of its inverse? So assume that the inverse map, so f is bijective, we have an inverse, we already know that, and assume we already know that if we have the inverse map, which goes the opposite direction, is differentiable in the image of A. So let's call this point B, so f of A. So what do we know about the derivatives? So can we also relate the derivative of the inverse to the derivative of f, the differential of the inverse to the differential of f? And the answer is yes. Namely, apply the chain rule to the following relations. First of all, just by definition of the inverse, we know that f to the minus 1 composed with f is the identity on u, and the other way around, f composed with f to the minus 1 is the identity on v, simply by definition of inverse maps. And since we have differentiability, there, this assumption there, if we apply the chain rule now in this point A, we know that, so the differential of the identity is the identity, just on Rn, not just on u, this is easy to see. But here we know that the differential of the composition is the composition of the differentials. So this yields that df minus 1, so the derivative, so not to put some parentheses in here, not to confuse, so this is the differential of this inverse map in B, composed with the differential of f in A, is the identity on Rn. And here we get the other way, the differential of f in A, composed with the differential of f inverse in B, is also the identity on Rn. So, but if we take a look at this, this just means that these are linear maps, and we see that dFA is an isomorphism because this here is the inverse. This is just the relation we need for this. This is an isomorphism, and we know that the inverse map, so dFA, the inverse of this isomorphism, this is given by that one, by the differential of f minus 1 in B. So the differential of the inverse map is the inverse of the differential as a linear map. And this is nice because this also means like the, I mean, this is something we can use for computation. We can compute the, so this relation here. This also tells us, if we look at the relation between Jacobi matrices and differentials, that the Jacobi matrix of the inverse is the inverse of the Jacobi matrix of F, and so on. So this leads to a beautiful relation, and there we can really use our inversion methods, and we can really solve this by determine the differential of F minus 1, basically by knowing this and knowing some tricks from linear algebra. So this is all we need to do, and so this is how we can really compute the inverse there. However, there's a problem with that theorem, because this already assumes that the inverse map is differentiable in that point. I mean, that f is bijective and differentiable, this is something that might be given. I mean, also to show that some arbitrary map between open subsets of Rn is bijective is not that trivial. We'll come back to this later, but let's assume we have that given. But usually, if f is a complicated map, it could be anything, f to the minus 1 will not be given explicitly, so there we won't have an explicit formula there. So we cannot really check if it's differentiable in that image point. So in some sense, so this is nice, but this is not really useful because it's not that applicable because these assumptions are hard to meet. Now, let's take a first step and take a look at, so when do we know that this inverse map is differentiable? And there is indeed a nice theorem which tells us that the inverse map is already differentiable, namely theorem 13.4. This is not the inverse function theorem yet. This is just some preliminary theorem. So let n and n u v be open subsets of Rn. F from u to v be bijective. Now, if f is differentiable in a point A in U, if f is differentiable in the point A, dFa, so the differential of f in A from Rn to Rn, is an isomorphism. So this is something, if we have f given explicitly, this is something we can check, we can compute. This is an isomorphism, and f to the minus 1, and now this is something we can maybe show for some reason, f to the minus 1 is continuous in the point B, which is defined to be f of A, then it follows that f to the minus 1 is differentiable in that point in B with differential d f to the minus 1 in B given by d f a inverse. Okay, so this is still quite a flaw because we still need to know that the inverse is continuous in that point, and we still might not know what the inverse looks like, but let's assume this is now given for some point. So then we already get a very big step forward, namely then implying the differentiability already. Okay, how to see this? So, first of all, some notation put, and now I'm picking up some notation I used already in the differentiability chapter. U prime shall be the set of all h in Rn such that a plus h is in U. And v prime shall denote the set of all h in Rn such that b plus h is in V. Okay. Just as a definition space for our for the equation to show the differentiability. So what we need to show, and this is just the shortcut of formulating differentiability, the limit as h goes to 0 of the following term, 1 over the norm of h of, and now we have to, this phi which appears in that equation of differentiability needs to vanish, and this phi needs to satisfy f of a plus h minus, f to the minus 1 of b plus h. Sorry, I want to show differentiability of f minus 1. Let me do this again. So here we have f to the minus 1 of b plus h minus f to the minus 1 on b, and then minus the map that we claim to be the differential, which is this here. So dFa to the minus 1 of h. And this difference here, this is the map we called phi in the definition of differentiability. So we need that 1 over the norm of h times this. This needs to vanish. So this, this should be 0. This is what we want to show. And equivalently, we could also just take the norm of everything and show that the norm goes to 0. And the norm of everything would be limit as h goes to 0. And now we can write this as a fraction, f to the minus 1 of b plus h minus f to the minus 1 of b minus dfa to the minus 1 of h to the norm divided by the norm of h. This has to be 0. Okay, let me give this equation a label. This is now a star we already had, so a double star. Okay, and now we first do some little playing around with the terms here. So first of all, we put r of h to abbreviate notation. We just define r of h to be f to the minus 1 of b plus h minus f to the minus 1 of b. Okay, just from the definition, b was defined such that it was the image of a, so this here is simply f to the minus 1 of b plus h minus a. So Just by construction, a plus r of h is f to the minus 1 of b plus h. And now since f minus 1 is invertible, we could just apply f to both sides of this equation and see that b plus h is the same as f of a plus r, plus r of h. Sorry. Just slight confusion, yeah. Okay, now, this is f of a plus, a plus r of h. Sorry, yeah, like this. So here we have a plus something. This expression already occurs in the definition of differentiability, except for this r, which doesn't matter here, because since f is differentiable in a, there exists some phi from u prime to Rn with limit as h goes to zero of phi of h to the norm divided by the norm of h is zero, such that f of a plus h is f of a plus dFa of h plus var phi of h. Okay, for all h in u prime. Now, we just need to replace this a plus h by a plus r of h. R of h is by construction some particular term, we don't care about the details now, but some part which is in definition there, so we could just insert this here instead of h itself, and then obtain an, another equation, and let me erase before we then see what we can do with that. So this is what we had, and from the differentiability of f that I stated before, we get that f of a plus r of h is f of a plus df in a applied to r of h plus phi of h, where phi is chosen as above for all h in u prime. But this is the same as we've seen f of a plus rh is this, so b plus h. And f of a is by definition b, plus the rest stays as it is, dfa of r of h plus phi of h. Now we can just subtract b everywhere and reorder the terms a bit. So this and this cancels each other out. And then we get that dfa of r of h is the same, if we now bring this to the other side, as h minus b. Phi of r of h. And no, not h in u prime. H needs to be in a suitable, suitably small. Let's not be too precise about that, but for small h. Okay, so we get that this then holds phi of r of h, same mistake here, r of h. So, we have this, and since dFa is an isomorphism by assumption, so dFa is an isomorphism, this yields that r of h is dFa inverse of h minus phi of r of h. Okay, and if we now insert here the definition here, this was just this part there, so then we get that f to the minus 1 of b plus h, oh, there's also equivalence here, minus f to the minus 1 of b, which is just this expression. This is the same as here. And if we now bring this to the other side as well, we get that this minus dfa of h is minus phi of r of h. So this is what we have here. And this particularly implies that the limit that we need to study, so this was the limit as h goes to zero of f to the minus 1 of b plus h minus f to the minus 1 of b. I forgot the inverse here. So this is the inverse of df of a, to be precise, not to confuse you, I hope. Like this. So this minus df a to the minus 1 of h. So this divided by this is the same. If we just now replace this by the other side, this is the limit as h goes to 0 of the norm of phi of r of h divided by the norm of h. The minus is killed by the norm, so this doesn't really matter. Now, this looks almost like it should go to 0, but only almost, because there's this r in the way. So what's the problem here? We know that norm of phi of something divided by this something goes to 0, but here is not r of h in the denominator, but h. So let's write this as the limit as h goes to 0 of a product, namely phi of r of h divided by r of h times, and now r of h to the norm divided by the norm of h. So here we know just by the property of phi, this goes to 0, but we don't know anything about this at this point. So we need to show that the whole thing is bounded, that the whole thing goes to 0. If this goes to 0, this expression needs to be bounded, because if this would explode to infinity or something, this might destroy the limits. So we need to show that this expression there, so r of h to the norm divided by the norm of h, is bounded in a neighborhood of 0, 0. And this part of the proof I want to skip, because this is very technical. This is fully carried out in the lecture notes. Okay, there it's also the fact that at this point we need that this assumption that we haven't need so far, the continuity of f to the minus 1 in B, because this continuity particularly implies, I mean, otherwise this limit, this couldn't be bounded then, because so this can only be bounded as a necessary condition if this denominator here, so since this denominator goes to 0 as h goes to 0, the numerator needs to go to 0 as well, otherwise it would be definitely unbounded. So we need that this goes to 0, but if we take a look at the definition of r, like this, there was the assumption that f to the minus 1 is continuous in h, so this first expression goes to f to the minus 1 of b as h goes to 0, which means the whole thing goes to 0. So here, this implies the limit of h going to 0 of r of h is 0. So otherwise, it couldn't be bounded. And this is what we really need there. And the rest of it is just very technical, technical computations. So let me skip the rest of the proof, and you'll find it in the lecture notes. OK, so this was the first thing. So from the continuity of the inverse map follows the differentiability. But still, it was part of the assumption that the map we're studying is bijective. So this is what we needed to know. So we need to know there is an inverse, and there is a the inverse is continuous at some point. So this is still quite something. So this is not that easy to prove. So we're not really happy with that. But it turns out that we don't need all these assumptions. We can basically simplify things here a bit. Namely, we can, this is still a valid statement, but we can find a better criterion, or a very simple criterion, to show that something is at least locally in some neighborhood of a point, maps some neighborhood bijectively onto another neighborhood. So this is something we can namely follow from that follows from the inverse function theorem, which we shall discuss next. So this is theorem 13.5. So this is the famous inverse function theorem, or inverse mapping theorem, I think, but this is the most common name. Okay, what does this tell us? So here we have much weaker assumptions than in the previous theorem. So that n and n, that W, this time we call the open set W, so the notation does not become too mixed up. W and Rn is open. F is some map from W to Rn, so again, same dimension, which is continuously differentiable. And we take one particular point A in W. Now, the only assumption that we need, apart from continuous differentiability, is that if the differential is an isomorphism, and this is something we can check really by only not doing calculus, but linear algebra, writing down the Jacobi matrix, checking if it's invertible, this is really just standard linear algebra. So if this is an isomorphism, then, sorry, already made the first mistake in the statement. If there's an isomorphism at that one point, then there exists an open neighborhood U, which is a subset of W as well, of A, so that the following properties hold. First of all, the restriction to U as a map from U to F of U, and this image F of U shall be defined as V. This is bijective. And V is open. Okay, so some open neighborhood of the point A is mapped onto some open neighborhood bijectively of F of A. Secondly, if we know that the differential is an isomorphism at one point, then we can choose the neighborhood so small that dfx at some point x in U is also an isomorphism. For all x in U. So it automatically follows if it's at some point an isomorphism, it's in, on a whole open subset. I mean, on this whole, we have some space around our point where, every, where it's everywhere an isomorphism. And third point, the inverse, which is now kind of the local inverse, so only between U and V, where we know it's bijective, this is continuously differentiable. So yeah, technically, so it's a bit imprecise. So actually, this would be the inverse of this restriction of F of U. So this would be the map, but we just call it F to the minus one just for simplicity. So this inverse map is continuously differentiable, and not only that, with d f to the minus 1 in the point f of a is d f a inverse. This holds for each x. df to the minus 1, f of x is dfx to the minus 1 for all x in U. And this is a mighty theorem because, first of all, we have some continuously differentiable map. We don't know much about this map. We just know it's differential in the point, so it's linear approximation. We approximate this by a linear map. And if it's a complicated map, we just take the linear map, which is closest to that map, and take a look if this one is bijective, which is an isomorphism. And if the approximation here is bijective, which we know how to check, we have linear algebra, then we can already find some space around this point where the map must be bijective. So from this knowledge about this vector space isomorphism, about this really rough approximation of the map, we can already show some really important big property of the map. Yeah, I hope you can see how excited I am about this theorem because this is really nice. Okay, so These properties hold, but to prove this, this really takes a while, and this takes some work. So let's go on towards the proof. So if you need to go to the bathroom, maybe go now. If you want to eat something now. Brace yourself, we're going to go through this step by step. Okay, we start off slowly, namely we make some elementary assumptions. And this is now, more precisely, we have two important without loss of generalities in here, or not important, but two loss of, without loss of generality. Where for both of them, I would say it's non-obvious why this is not a loss of generality. The first one is we assume without loss of generality that the differential at A, which is some isomorphism, we don't know, is the identity. Okay, this seems very rough. I mean, this is some particular isomorphism, but why is this not a loss of generality? So if this was not the case, then we could do the same thing, the same line of argument, replace F by the following map, G, which is defined as the composition of F, and we put in front dFA to the minus 1. We just know that this is some isomorphism, which we know. Then by the chain rule, dG of A is the identity. And basically, yeah, it follows that, so you can easily see, or maybe not that easy because this is an isomorphism, G has these properties, properties 1, 2, and 3. If and only if F has these properties. So we can just start off by assuming that, even from the start, not replacing F by G, but just taking F and assuming that this is here the case. So this is really not a loss of generality. Okay, for the second loss of non-loss of generality, I need to erase, and then we'll go on with the proof. The second assumption, assume without loss of generality that the point A is just zero, so it's, yeah, W is an open neighborhood of zero, and that F of A is zero. So if this is not the case, we replace F by another map, which this time I call capital G, and capital G is then defined by F of X plus A minus F of A. Okay, then this, sorry about that, little mistake. So we replace this by this map, and so we then first of all see that G of zero is zero, and that the differential of G, I mean, we see this differentiable, this is some constant term which vanishes when deriving, but we see here that the differential of G in X is, in zero, is the same as the differential of F in this point, in this X plus A, in zero plus A, which is just A, and nothing more because the derivative of this expression there is just the identity. So this has the same differential, so we can basically check everything and check that G satisfies, G has properties 1, 2, and 3, if and only if F has these properties. So we can just replace then F by G, so instead we assume that this here holds true from the beginning, so that A is zero and F of A is zero. This just simplifies some formulas later on, so we have one less variable to worry about. Now, I'm putting this proof in several steps because this is quite a lot to digest. So in the first step, I want to show there exists an R bigger than zero, such that for k defined as the closed ball of radius 2r around 0, we will later on see why I'm choosing 2r here, such that for this closed ball, dfx is an isomorphism for all x in k. So this was the first thing we had seen, that there was some open neighborhood, but this is an isomorphism, but then we could, of course, just take the interior, but in fact, we will take something smaller, not this ball, but for this closed ball K, oops, sorry about my terrible handwriting, this closed or compact ball of radius 2R has this property. This is what we want to show, that we can find such an R. Now, how do you do this? So first of all, we know that F is continuously differentiable. So, in particular, this means that if we consider the partial derivatives in some point x, if x goes to zero, these partial derivatives will turn to the partial derivative at zero. This is what continuously differentiable means. So for all I in 1 to n, so this particularly is true. Now, this means, because these go closer and closer together, this means that there exists some r bigger than zero, such that for all x in this, and now we already have it, k, the closed ball of radius 2r around zero, we get that the norms of the partial derivatives, so of df in x minus df in zero, this is just some difference of vectors in Rn, so we have here just the Euclidean norm. This here becomes very small. In fact, this becomes smaller than or equal to, and now 1 over 2 times n to the 3 over 2. This is one of these proofs where later on everything works out magically, and then we will kind of, this is precisely what we will need. But we could choose any small epsilon here. We could always find some r just by continuity such that this would hold true in this ball of radius r. So that this holds true for all x in k and all I from 0 to, from 1 to n. Of course, first of all, we get such an R on Ri for each individual I, and we just take the smallest of all of these different radii that we get, and then we have this one radius where this works for all I at the same time. Okay, now given this, we make the following computation. For all x in k and v vectors in Rn, where I label the components by v1 to vn, as we did lots of times before, we do the following computation. Namely, we make a nice estimate. If we take the norm of v minus dfx of v, so this is the identity of v, so this is the same as df0 of v minus dfx in v. Now, by the formulas that we know for the relation between the differential and the partial derivatives, we can just write this down in terms of the partial derivatives. Namely, this is the same as the norm of the sum I from 1 to n, dIf in 0, vi minus the sum I from 1 to n, dIf in x, vi taken to the norm. Okay? So this can, of course, be written as one big sum. So we could just erase one summation sign and just put these in parentheses here. And then use the triangle inequality for the norm iteratively. And then we see that the norm of a finite sum is always smaller than or equal to the sum over the norms. So this is smaller than or equal to the sum from 1 to n of the norm of dIf of 0 times vi minus this vi. So let's put the vi already at the end. Minus dIf of x vi. Here's a parenthesis missing. So this vi can just be treated like a constant term, and we know what constant terms do in the norm. We can just factor them out. So by taking the absolute value, so this is the same as the sum from 1 to n of the norm of dIf of 0 minus dIf of x times the absolute value of vi, oh, here's the norm missing, like this. Now, this here, we have estimated this. This is just the other way around. This is just minus this term, and of course the signs don't matter if we study the norm. So each of them can be estimated. So this is smaller than the sum from 1 to n of 1 over 3 over n, 3 over 2 times the absolute value of vi, but this is, of course, for each vi, you can always see this was the standard estimate here, that the absolute value of each component is less than or equal to the norm of the whole vector. So this is the same as norm, sum from 1 to n, 1 over n to the 3 over 2 times norm v. And now we have no I in there anymore, so this is just n times the same term, means this is n divided by n over n to the 3 over 2 times V, and this is of course even simpler, and let me just summarize what we've shown. So we've started with norm of V minus dfx of V, and then just estimated this to the smaller than or equal, smaller than or equal, and so on, until we arrived here, and this is then just 1 by the power laws, 1 over n to the power of 1/2, but this is the same as 1 over the square root of n times the norm of V. Okay, this is what we have here. Now, so there we needed this estimate here. This was the crucial part. Okay, given this equation, we want to now want to show that dfx is an isomorphism right from this equation. Namely, we see maybe let's do it like this. So by corollary 723, we've seen, so the map is a linear map between Rn and Rn. So we've seen it's an isomorphism if and only if it is injective, if and only if it is surjective. But it suffices to show that dfx is injective everywhere in K. So by this corollary, it suffices to show dfx is injective for all x in K. And this is by another theorem whose number I haven't here. We have seen linear map is injective if and only if its kernel is trivial. So kernel of d of x is just 0 for all x in K. Okay, now what do we do? We assume that x is in K, and we assume that V lies in the kernel of dfx. Then the norm of V, if V is in the kernel, this is the same as this expression here, because then this is 0. So this is the norm of V minus dfx of V. And so by using this equation inequality here, so I think I already had star and double star, so let's make a triple star. So by this estimate, this is smaller than or equal to 1 over the square root of n times the norm of V. Somewhere I've forgotten a 2, I think. It's not really, here we had a 2, and this one I have just thrown out. Of course, here we had a 2 then, and here we have a 2, and here we have a 2, and here we have a 2. Sorry, just to be precise. And then we also get a 2 here. It's not relevant for this, but for comes later. But now we see, so this means 1 minus the 1 over 2 square root of n of the norm of V is smaller than or equal to 0 if we just subtract this side here by this term. But again, this cannot happen because here n is some natural number. So here's, this is 1/2 or smaller. So this here will always be positive. This is a norm, so it's bigger than or equal to 0. So this can only become smaller than or equal to 0 if we are precisely 0. And this means the norm of V is 0, which is always equivalent to V equal to 0. Hence, the kernel of df of x is 0, since we've taken an arbitrary element and we've shown it must be 0. So this shows that dfx is an isomorphism for all x in K. Okay, this was the first step. So this is what we've shown so far. So that this property that the differential is an isomorphism near that point already follows. Second part, we want to show that there exists a neighborhood V in Rn of 0 such that, now we come to some existence part here, such that for all y in V, there exists some x in K with f of x is equal to y. This is what we need for the bijectivity here. So there is a neighborhood of V such that this is kind of map, so that F maps a whole neighborhood onto that neighborhood. this is what we want to show next. And this is where the Banach fixed point theorem comes in. So, namely, we have this equation f of x is equal to y. This is what we need to solve. And again, we search for the solutions of an equation, and the idea is now to turn this into a fixed point problem in the following way. So we fix some y so that for some y in Rn in the beginning, so we will later on see that we will need to restrain ourselves to something smaller, but for y in Rn, we define a map phi y, which goes from W to Rn, namely phi y of x is by definition y plus x minus f of x. Okay, nothing very fancy, but the idea is here the following. Then f of x is equal to y, so what happens then? This is the case that these two cancel each other out and only this remains, and other way around. So this is equivalent to phi y of x is x. So this has a solution for this particularly given y, if and only if this map phi y associated to this has a fixed point. So x is a fixed point of phi y. So you can guess what we want to do now. We want to apply Banach's fixed point theorem again. But the problem is, of course, we need to show when this is a contraction. And this is not that easy. And there it turns out you cannot just choose every y, but we just need to restrain to take y in a neighborhood of zero. And then we will show that this is then, in fact, a contraction if y is close enough to zero. Let me erase and then we will see that.